emergency?
My daughter, we just found her in bed, and she's got a lash on her arm, and she's all bloody.
Just before 5 o'clock, we received a call of a potential suicide at the Pagel residence.
Officers are immediately dispatched to the home of 41-year-old Renee Pagel.
We were met by Renee's stepmother and her father. They were both just in shock. Renee's father indicated that his daughter was in her bedroom. When I first walked into the bedroom, I observed Renee laying on the bed. I could just remember seeing all the blood. The blood-soaked sheets, her shirt, there's blood on her face. It was obvious that Renee Pagel was deceased, and it wasn't a suicide. This was a homicide.
Officers secure the scene as homicide detectives arrive to investigate.
Her bedroom was incredibly blood-soaked, unlike I'd ever seen before. The bed was covered with blood. There was blood spatter on the walls, on the ceiling.
She was stabbed multiple times. I was pretty shocked by the amount of wounds that she had. When I looked at her hand, I saw a large laceration almost in the middle of her hand to be, in my opinion, a defensive wound. Renee was in the fight for her life. Unfortunately, she had lost.
For detectives, the viciousness of the attack is a clue itself.
It appears to us it's a crime of passion. Somebody has something against this victim so much so that they want to brutalize this person as much as they possibly could.
This was personal.
Somebody went into that residence to murder Renee.
Who in Renee's life would want to attack her and could be capable of such violence?
Her friend called me and said, Chris, Renee's dead. It was surreal. I remember curling up in a fetal position and just screaming. I screamed. I was angry.
As her friends and loved ones struggle with her death, Renee's autopsy report comes in.
Cause of death was blunt force trauma, homicide. It was a large, heavy-duty knife that was used on her.
The autopsy revealed upwards of 50 stab wounds. There were numerous lacerations to the hands and the feet, suggesting defensive wounds.
She was stabbed over 50 times. I'm still reeling from that one. It was so brutal.
Detectives continue their investigation and now focus their attention on Renee's tenant, Mike Decker.
She had this barn that had an upstairs apartment, and he was a renter.
The barn was about 75 yards away from the main home. He could have been involved, he could have been a witness, he could have overheard something. One of her friends believed that the week of her surgery, Renee was going to have pizza with Mike Decker, and that she felt that there was some type of maybe a relationship going on. So that sparked our interest. I mean, if he's having a relationship with Renee, did something happen to cause him to get upset and potentially do this horrific crime? We had to find him immediately.
This case was a giant mystery. We had no murder weapon. We had no real evidence.
We really needed cooperation. We needed somebody that had information about what had happened that would help us break this case open. Bo laid out the story for us, and he told us that Mike took the knife and threw it into the river.
So I said, we need to find that murder weapon however we can.
We drove over to Saginaw and met Bo on the bridge that he described. He pointed in the direction of where the knife would have been thrown and made no hesitation or question about whether or not it was in the right area. He was certain this is where it was.
February 5th, 2020, 15:29 p.m. It's the Birch Creek off Moore Road near Saginaw.
We couldn't excavate the shoreline. We couldn't remove the trees. We had to find another means to search the bottom of the river. And without being able to do it manually, the only other option was to try and use some type of magnet to grab whatever metal pieces were on the bottom of the river. So we tied ropes to either side and drug the magnet back and forth, kind of as a trolley, and had it scrape the bottom of the river and keep moving to make sure we covered every inch of that river.
Some of the metal objects that were pulled out of the river.
We found everything from old rusted pieces of metal to an old gas furnace. We found car parts. We found a Christmas tree stand, shotgun shells. We found all kinds of stuff. So we didn't really expect to find anything toward the end.
We're just kind of hoping for a break, and fortunately we got one.
For a crime like this to take place in Cortland Township, even in Kent County, is very rare. The feeling of walking in that home and into that bedroom, it was an eerie feeling. You could sense that something evil had taken place that night.
What struck me about this case that was kind of odd, there was no other areas in the house that were disturbed. Nothing's missing that I could see, because throughout the house you see electronics, you're seeing credit cards, jewelry, money. Nothing's taken.
We didn't see any forced entry in any of the doors. There was nothing that appeared to be out of place. The entire event was clear to us that it occurred inside of that bedroom. It wasn't out into a living room and then carry into the bedroom or anywhere else in the house. It was just centralized right in that bedroom.
And there was nothing outside that would indicate that anything had taken place inside the residence. I walked up and down checking the ditches on both sides of the road, 10 to 15 feet off the roadway, looking for a murder weapon. Anything that would help solve this case. The murder weapon was not located. It was the most bizarre scene I've ever been on.
Just